the middle, still going, Peacock. Oh, what a try! That is T.R.Y. To Peacock, and Jamie Peacock scores the first Bradford try.
Come on then, mate. Are you coming? I can't do this on my own.
Boy, it's all right.
That's a beautiful song for an ugly bugger like you.
It's true, yeah. It doesn't suit, does it? Beauty and the Beast there.
But it does. That is a lovely song to go with that. You wouldn't think that song would go with that action, but... You know why? Where does that come from?
So that came from I think around 2007, 2008. I was thinking about retiring. I was about 32, and I was doing my autobiography because I thought I've only got a couple more seasons. I ended up playing about seven more seasons, but and at the point couldn't decide of a name for the autobiography. So that song was out at the moment, No White Flag, and I thought it's really apt, suits my autobiography. And then it was on the name of my book, and then I thought I'd just use it for the videos, and just kind of summed up the way I try to play the game, you know, don't give up and don't give up on what you're doing.
Does it still endure now, or has it sort of had that era now? That
yeah,
have we got an old video?
Yeah, I think it gives. I get good memories, you know, from watching it, but that's what they are, memories. I try to look forward in life rather than. Look back too much on my career and that. I think we're going to come into it, but seeing that video, it feels like a different world to me now. You know, I think was that me doing that? It always astounds me how many different faces I pulled carrying the ball as well. I was good at gurning as well, I think, by the looks of it.
Well, now you're a celeb and a star and in a different world, you know, you've got to be careful in faces, haven't you?
Yeah.
Even the punditry as well, you did the World Cup, you're looking very handsome on that World Cup, by the way.
Well, it's funny what makeup can do, right, Paul? But yeah, look, it was good. You know what? I think for me, it's a privilege of doing the BBC stuff and being part of that, to be involved in the big games, you know, the Challenge Cup, but also the World Cup as well. And I never look on that as work, you know. I would do that work for free because it's just so enjoyable to be part of those big games, those big occasions. And it's just, yeah, I really enjoy that side of it.
So this is the penultimate gig of our Sewell Convention Week. The last one will be our Star Awards tonight at the Hilton, where you'll have your party. You were never averse to celebrating the wins, were you? Do you still believe that?
Yeah.
Or is winning a different type of thing now, Jamie?
I think when you, first of all, the first part of it, I really believe you should enjoy success. You know, I think that's an important part of it. I think success, there's always a price to pay for success, whether you're in sport, in business, and you should recognise it and reward those moments because, you know, we get to our end of our lives, that's what we'll remember, the peaks and troughs we have in our lives. Our lives don't stay the same. You just don't have the... Now, I'm not in sport. You just don't have the same highs and lows, you know. There's not a feeling of winning a grand final. I'm not going to get that back. I'm not going to replicate the feeling of winning for Great Britain or winning a Challenge Cup. But I do enjoy the wins around, like, kind of deliver excellence in what I do. I'm a big believer in that because I work for myself, and if I'm not delivering excellence, then I've got no work, basically. So, for me, you know, I tend to... focus on each day, did I do a good job today? You know, where have I added value? Where have I done a good job today? And then I'll get to the end of the week, look back at my week and think, you know what, have I got it right this week? Have I nailed it this week? Has it been where I want it to be? And if it has, then I'll go do something. I'll go enjoy the wins. I'll celebrate some success. With that, go out for a nice meal, do something with my family. That's how I see enjoying the wins for me now. It's more end of week rather than big Challenge Cup grand final winning moments, but it's still integral to my day-to-day life.
Yeah. So, on reflection of that career, what do you think was the biggest achievement? And has that changed from when you come out of your career, you thought the biggest achievement was that? Is it different now that that's a few years ago?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think a couple of achievements I'm proud to be involved with would have been... 2006, captaining Great Britain to beat Australia in 2006 down under in Sydney.
Jimmy, we've got some Aussies in
there. I've seen them,
You've seen them,
let me have my one taste of victory there. But I think for me as a group, the biggest challenge in any walk of life is play against the benchmark, and you know, whether it's in business or sport, but can you beat the benchmark? But can you beat the benchmark in sport in their own country? And we were able to do that day in 2006. And it will always stay with me. And I think it's significant that, you know, 17 years on now, and England and Great Britain have still not managed to accomplish that. And out of all my stuff, believe it or not, at home, it's just all my trophies. I just kept out of the way. But the only thing I've got framed is the shirt from that day. That's the only thing I've got framed. And for me... it's still the most significant thing, because I think if you can beat the best in the world, that still remains a huge achievement for me. And look, as a kid, you know, my boyhood dream was to play for Great Britain. I remember watching my heroes playing for Great Britain, like Ellery Hanley. And to go on and then captain Great Britain and captain a team that beats the Aussies in Sydney, it's just still to this day is. And then I think just at the end of my career, 2015, with the Rhinos, managed to... with that group of guys to win the treble, I thought it was an incredible achievement. Went through a lot of adversity that year to get to where we got to. And I think to finish my career, certainly the Leeds Rhinos winning the grand final off the back of winning the others was just special. I don't look back too often, but if I did, they'd be the two I'd pick out.
So both those were great teams.
Yeah.
What is it about a team? What's the essence of a team? And I know you do the business stuff now, and I'd like you to speak on both, really, Jamie.
Yeah, I think in great teams, I think, first of all, everybody's got to do the job. They've got to know the role and do the job and understand how that contributes to the great part of the team. I think in great teams as well, players And just people in business put the side before themselves. You know, they'll commit to the side, they get rid of their ego, they'll do whatever's right for the team. And I think when we were at the Rhinos, no one cared about who got the credit for winning. No one was really bothered about it at an individual level. We all just wanted to be the best we could be, and we knew if we could deliver excellence, you know, individually, then as a team, we've got a fair chance of winning. So, and I think that's the same in business too, is, you know, if you get rid of the egos, don't care who gets the credit, you know, all work hard and want to deliver excellence, then you've got a team, I reckon. You've got a team and you've got some purpose.
The lovely word is excellence, isn't it? It's bandied about a lot. But here, as the guys will know, we don't think it's an aspiration, we're going to be excellent. Excellence is what you do in the next 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Do you do that in an excellent fashion? Would you agree with that?
Oh, 100%. I think excellence is just that's how I measure myself, right, honestly, because there's no end game with excellence. There's no go, well, I'm excellent, I'll quit today. You know, like, you can do that every single day. Like, you can do it in every single task that you ever do. And I think that's the mental toughness side of being a champion, is the ability to consistently deliver excellence in whatever you decide to do. And that's a challenge. And, you know, the best players you ever play in sport are the guys. James Robey's one at the moment who's playing in the game. James Robey consistently delivers excellence in everything that he does. It's taken him 20 years to get to that level. And I think in business, in sport, that's the same, should be the same kind of motivator. You know, have I been excellent today? Am I excellent in this meeting? Have I been excellent in this training session? Did I deliver like excellence in that game? And I think it's such a great motivator to have.
Consistently high level, but that involves leadership as well, Jamie. Could you talk about your concept of leadership? You know, the best leaders you played under, what you think makes a great leader, both in business and sport. Can you talk about the leadership thing for a bit?
Yeah, I think one of the big fundamentals with leadership is delivering on your word. So it's delivering on your word in terms of what you do in your own performance, but delivering on your words in terms of your commitment to your teammates or to the people you're trying to lead. And I think the best leaders consistently deliver on the word. They always do what they say they're going to do. You know, one of the biggest things that I see perhaps in business with leaders or a downfall is that they like miss one-to-ones with people all the time. And I think that's a sign of not delivering on your word. And I think I try to keep it as simple as possible. And I think as a leader, if you can deliver on your word to yourself in delivering excellence, well, you lead by example, won't you? Because you set high standards. But then if you can deliver on your word to the people who's trying to lead, you know, when you commit to do something or you say you're going to do something for someone and continually push through with that, I think it creates a lot of trust in your team and a lot of care for your team. And that, for me, is like, to try and encapsulate in a sentence, it would be around that one, Paul.
Yeah, we've got the same, haven't we? You know, always do what you say you're going to do, but we add and always run towards your problem. You'll always get problems. If you start running away from problems, yeah, That's when it goes wrong. Always run towards your problems.
I played with a few players who run away from problems.
No names. This is getting streamed. Can we just talk about adversity? Because winners actually act the right in adversity. We can't win all the time. We have the bad time. What was your worst time looking back at the...
Yeah, I've had some crap times as a player, like really bad times. And I think failure is part of the journey to being successful. I really think... pardon me, you've got to learn from it. You've got to learn from your failures. You know, amongst all the success I had as a player in the teams that I was involved in, there were lots of lost games, you know, lost finals, injuries. And I think for me, the key with, if thinking that you fail, is when something goes wrong that for you, what I tend to do is I think you've got to own it, first of all, as a person. I think lots of people who don't learn from failure don't own it. They just want to blame somebody else. And then I think as well in our lives, what's worked for me is just forgiving yourselves. Like, it's all right to make a mistake, you know, it's all right to have a setback, it's all right to lose a game. These things kind of happen in life. And then what worked for me was, you know, once you do those two things, you know, like own it and accept that mistakes are part of life, I think for me then, it's just trying to improve. What am I going to do, right? So the next time I play in a final, I'm going to be slightly better at what I'm doing, or the next time I deliver a coaching session to someone, I'm going to be better at what I've done, or next time I deliver a talk, how can I be a little bit better at what I've done? And then, like, my fourth kind of thing that works for me, and that's throughout my career, is just context about not taking life too seriously sometimes. I think I learned a lot of that from yourself. I think you can be serious, but not take life too seriously at times, and I think that there's... I think the difference between our good days and our bad days is kind of what life's about, right? That difference, like, in emotion and in feeling. And I think that's something we should embrace. So if we've failed at something, yeah, you're probably going to feel pretty crappy about it. But maybe embrace that feeling, because if you decide to own it, and then if you decide to do something about it and you have a success, that difference in emotions, what's life's all about.
You're mellowing, aren't you?
Yeah, yeah, I am.
I remember when I first met you, if somebody beat you to a car parking spot, there was bother.
I have changed a lot, and I reckon in the last 7 years we're not playing, yeah? 7, 8 years, hugely, I think, in terms of that, like, mellowing out a bit.
I remember there was a really bad time, because you were Bradford Bulls, massively successful at Bradford Bulls. World champions there?
Yeah.
World champions at Bradford Bulls. Then you had the move to the Rhinos. You signed a pre-contract agreement and it got out. And it caused a lot of problems for you. Do you just want to tell these guys that story?
I signed for the Leeds Rhinos in February 2005. I'd been having discussions with the Bradford Bulls. I was captain of the club, and they were, you know, saying there's no more money at the club. So I wanted to stay there. But just what they were offering was just not in the right, just not fair. Not fair. So I started talking to Rhinos, and I thought, do you know what I mean? I'm going to do it. It's my hometown club. So I signed for him in like February 2005, beginning of the season. And then it came out June 2005 that I was moving to the Rhinos. And now lots of players were leaving that year, but because I was moving to the main rivals, all the hate was directed at me. Do you want to talk about those letters? So all the hate was directed at me. We were going through a rough time at the moment. We were like six in the league out of 12 sides, instead of usually first or second. We lose a game against St. Helens, get a man sent off, get beat 64-10, get booed off the pitch, pint pots thrown down at us. And it's pretty dismal dressing room to get into.
So there is a worse thing than the stadium emptying. It's when they stop and throw things at you.
Yeah, throw stuff at you. Like, people are tight in Bradford as well, so full pint pots of lager, you're thinking, you know what?
They really mean it.
Get into the dressing room, and like, Oddsall staying there, dressing room doors open, you still hear all this booing coming in. Look around, all the lads are all just down in the dumps. And so we go home Monday, come back into work, and Telegraph and Argus, local Bradford paper, they're giving it us as well, you know, worst bull side in history. Then we train, training's not good, but I get two fans' letters that day. And basically, I open one of them, and one of them was, its opening line was, I think you are scum and Judas, you know, and the basic premise of the letter was, I hope you get injured when you move to the Rhinos, you don't deserve to wear the Bradford shirt, you shouldn't be here anymore, you're a disgrace, you know, that was his personal letter to me. So I've read this, and I've, you know, you think all the booing, media on top of you, personal letter gets on top of you a bit as a bloke, as a person, which meant I didn't open the other letter till a little bit later, but like 4 or 5 hours later, I opened the other letter. And the other letter was an amazing letter. It was from a woman. And her theme of the letter was, just stick together. You know, if you stick together, work hard, ignore what people are saying about you, then you've got a chance of winning the trophy. I'd like to see you win the trophy at the end of the year. And that, for me, the penny dropped. I thought, do you know what? It's probably the message like the boys need to hear the next day. So next day, dressing room, speak about the letter. Speak about like the difference that we've got to start ignoring people who tell us we can't do things. And start surrounding ourselves with people that believe in us, right? And you could see, like, you can see when you connect with a group, you get lots of good eye contact, lots of nodding head. But as you know, in sport, it's about winning. And off the back of that, we won 13 out of our next 15 games. And the last thing I ever did was lift the Super League trophy in the grand final. Old Trafford became the first side to finish outside the top two. Now, that taught me a great lesson that in life, you know, in difficult situations, you are going to get surrounded with negativity, but there's also positive people there. And that's the thing you've got to surround yourself with, the people who genuinely believe in you. Not people who blow smoke up your ass, but the people who genuinely believe in you and positive influence. They're the people to listen to in life. They're the people to surround yourself with, not the naysayers. Because generally the people who are naysayers won't have a chance of being able to do what you can do anyway.
And it's your choice of who you listen to as well, isn't it? Yeah. That's the one choice. You don't have a choice about what they say, but you have a choice about who you listen to.
Yeah, 100%. I think that's something I got more into as I finished playing, like that kind of stoicism that everything in our event, everything in our life is neutral. You know, basically, every event that ever happens in our life is neutral. Then we'll decide whether it's positive or negative off the back of it. You know, like you say in sport, you can lose a game. Well, you can decide but that's negative and you're going to get pissed off about it. Or you can say, do you know, it's a positive. We can take some learnings out and go forward with it. And I think that's something that's probably helped me chilled out a lot more since I finished playing, that kind of looking at things a little bit more neutral with it.
So can we go right back to the beginning? Because what we normally do at Elevens is to try to get to know a bit more about you. Ask you what the first record... I mean, we don't buy records anymore, but in our room we did. What's the first record you bought?
So the first record I bought was, there was a newsagent shopping, the Bramley Shopping Centre near where I lived, and it was called Martin's, and the record I bought was a One Hit Wonder by an Aussie band, believe it or not. I can't believe I bought an Australian music first, but it was Midnight Oil, The Beds Are Burning. So some people from the 80s might know that song. It was a great song, I loved it, and that was my
but
first.
But it didn't embarrass you now? You're still happy with
it? But I think it's a good song still now, so yeah, that's my first. So
where did you get the money from to buy
that
record?
So I had like, with my mum and dad, I had pocket money with conditions though, like, so conditions that you do a couple of jobs around the house, make sure your bedroom's tidy. If we ask you to wash the dishes, that gets done, or you don't get your pocket money, get your pocket money off the back of that.
So what type of kid were you?
I was a pretty... I look back and I was probably quite shy, but I was determined and had a will to be myself, but I was not real loud. You know, I'll tell that. A story I look back on, right, that before I thought just normal, but maybe not, maybe other people do this. So as a 9-year-old, right, in the 80s, Tears for Fears, remember, Rule the World, the song. But it was all that time, there was all that famine in Africa. And at that point, everyone started... That song got changed to Everybody Run the World, right? And there was a load of charity runs being done, 5K charity runs. So I used to watch this on Newsround, like with John Craven, as a 9-year-old. So I said to my mum, I want to do one of those. I want to do one of those 5K runs. And she went, you can't do one of them. You're 9, you're not allowed off the street. So I went, all right, okay. Next day I came back and went, Mum, I've been around our street and I've walked around and I reckon if I run this 25 times, it's 5K. So can I do this? And she agreed to do it. And then I reckon I got a sponsor sheet, got my neighbours to sponsor me, got my my family to sponsor me. And I raised, I think, like £26 summer for the kids in Ethiopia. I managed to get a little piece. My mum put it in the local Pudsey Times. And to me, I was
thought, the Pudsey Times?
Pudsey Times, yeah, yeah.
A renowned,
exactly. And I reckon
you still got that clip?
No, I ain't got it now, mate. Jeez. But I remember being proud as a 9-year-old that I'm in the paper the Pudsey Times. But I just thought, I don't think that's quite a normal story, you know, and I think it probably leads to a bit of who I am today, that I found a way to do something. Didn't take no as an answer. And I wanted to help people out. So I think in that story, I kind of my fundamentals of who I still am today a bit. Do you know that I won't take no for an answer. I'll find a way and I want to try and help people. So I think there is something in that, you know.
So are winners, as a champs, are they born or are they made?
I think it's a bit of both. It's got to be both. Nature and nurture. I was really lucky to be in some great environments. The Bradford Bulls environment was a great environment. It was full of like humble, hard-working players. Just got on with things, didn't have any egos. Had some good coaches, and I think I just like blossomed in those environments because I had those attributes inside me. But I think it's a great question, but I do believe it's a bit of both. I think you have to have some intrinsic ability or values or character, but then I think if you're in the right environment, then you'll grow exponentially.
We came to the game late, didn't you?
Yeah.
Relatively late into Bradford. Do you want to tell the story about getting to Bradford?
Yeah, I can tell the story.
I think it's a good life lesson for those of you who haven't heard it.
Yeah, so like growing up with rugby, I played rugby because I liked playing with mates. I wasn't really that good, you know. I played from 5 to 16 and never made it, never got picked for Leeds, Yorkshire or England. I was never good enough to do it. So no one signed me at 16 years of age. Kept playing, you know, for my amateur club because I love playing with my mates. Got to nearly 19 years old. Bradford Bull Scouts started to come and watch me play. Watch a few games and they speak to my coach, speak to my dad, and they want me to come and train with the first team for a morning, you know, see if I've got the potential to be a professional rugby league player. So I'm in a pretty crappy job at the time then. So I think this is great. I changed my life forever. So I say, yeah, of course I'll do it. Then as soon as I say, yeah, I start thinking, well, I've got to go train like with my heroes now, people I watch on BBC and ITV and Sky Sports. So I had a lot of self-doubt. But I thought, I've got to do it. Week later, catch the bus from where I live, didn't drive, 508 bus up from Leeds to Bradford, it's about an 8-mile journey, and on this bus journey, get more and more self-doubt because I'm sat on my own on this bus thinking this is going to be hard, they're going to be miles better than me, I'm not good enough to do this. So I get to my bus stop and I bottled it and I stayed on the bus. Now I stayed on the bus I had to get off the bus in Halifax, terminated at this point, so I got off this bus and you can imagine.
So you should have been at Oddsall.
Yeah.
And you was in Halifax.
Halifax, yeah. And I had no mobile phone, it's 1996, so I've no mobile phone. What am I going to do here now? So I ring my dad. Explain what's happened. So I find a payphone, ring him. He's a bit upset, you know. He teaches me some new swear words that day when he speaks back to me. But he does say, like, catch the bus home and we'll have a chat. So then, waiting for the bus and, you know, on the bus journey, I'm thinking about things. And what came to me was, I had a lot of people around me who clearly believed in me. You know, my dad did, the coaches did, the scouts did. But I was going to have to believe in myself if I wanted to take up this opportunity. And I had to realise that with big challenges comes self-doubt. It's natural to have that. So I thought to myself, I'll come up with a saying to reinforce my mindset on the way home. And the one I came up with was time to get off the bus, right? Clever. But time to get off the bus. So I got home, spoke to my dad. And he said, you know what, they're going to give you one more shot next week, but that's it, below that, and it's gone forever. All week then at work, I tell myself, time to get off the bus, believe in yourself, you can go do it. Get on the bus the following week, keep telling myself, time to get off the bus, you can go do it. Get to my bus stop, and I go train with the Bradford Bulls. Now, look, it was, for me at the time, it was a tough, intense training session, but I think you'll all realise in this room, like, when you confront your biggest fears, they're nowhere near as bad as you think they're going to be. I realised that. Started on a journey to get a professional contract. 12 weeks later, I got a professional contract. But also learned a life lesson then that stayed with me, that it's all right to have some self-doubt. Like, self-doubt's natural in big situations where there's big challenges in front of me. What you got to do, though, you got to master that self-doubt and you got to push through it. Because if you do, then generally, your greatest achievements will come up the other side of that. So I use that, you know, the first time I played for Great Britain, use that the first time I delivered a talk in front of so many people. Every time I come across a big challenge, I'll sit back on that memory made that day, knowing that it's all right to feel some nerves, it's part of the process, but I've just got to back myself, just got to believe in myself.
Because from getting off the bus to going to Australia with Great Britain and that first try, wasn't that long, was it?
No, exactly. So, yeah, so I got off the bus in 96, remember, debut in 99, 2001, 30 games later, I'll get picked to play against the Aussies.
So this is 30 games?
Yeah, 30 games.
Playing in Australia?
Yeah, I'm playing against Australia. So, you know, David Waite, the coach, tells me I'm in the team, and I'm like, right, it's great, I'm going to get tickets for my mum, my dad, my mates, sisters, everyone's coming to watch me play against the Aussies. But then on my journey through the hotel, back to my hotel room, I start thinking, I'm playing the best team in the world here, like in 6 days. And the negative self-thought starts, like, you've only played 30 first team games. You know, all this doubt comes in again because you're playing the best team in the world. And I get into my hotel room, and instead of thinking about tickets, what I'm thinking is I'm letting my country down. Because the one thing I do know in sport, if you don't believe you're going to win, then you ain't got a chance. You're not going to win. And I wrestled with that, I reckon, for 20 minutes. When I have that moment of clarity, I go, do you know what? It's the same situation. I'm going to have to get off the bus again. So after that moment of realisation, I tell myself all week, time to get off the bus, good enough to beat the Aussies. And then I start the game, and I take the second carry of the game, make the first tackle of the game, and then I scored a try in under 2 minutes, and we beat the Aussies. You know, we beat them that day. So it really cemented myself that it's all right to have self-doubt. You've got to believe yourself.
That was a massive pivotal moment, though, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was huge. You know, you're playing against the best team in the world, And with under 2 minutes, you scored a try on debut. I remember walking back thinking, you know, life don't get any better than this, you know, but still over 80 minutes to play it, like. But I remember that. And there's a couple of byproducts off that is that my local rugby club, Stanley, got £2,000 given to them by Guinness on a big screen because they put out that if anybody could score a try and under the time it takes to pour a perfect pint of Guinness, the amateur club would get £2,000. And I reckon they signed that off in the sponsorship, but no one's ever going to do that. And I did it in under like 120 seconds. But then my dad was at the game. And after getting the bar afterwards, I thought he's going to be buzzing my dad. You know, he's going to be really happy about all this. First thing he says to me, he goes, "You've cost me £500. And I went, "What?" And he says, "Do you know what? I have £10 on you for first try scorer every game, 50 to 1. It's Remembrance Sunday, all the bookies are shut. I'd have won £500 if it wasn't that." So it keeps you grounded, right?
We're going to come away from the rugby league career. Yeah. But seeing as we've got some rugby league fans here, we will take a couple of questions if you've got any burning questions to ask Jamie, because I know there's rugby league fans come today as well as people. We're going to talk about the Building Champions programme shortly. But is there anything up to now that you've heard Jamie say on his career, including our guests, you know, is there any questions on that before we leave the career behind? Because we'll be talking about his career in 2 hours' time if we don't watch it. Who has a question on that? Pam?
Patrick Sewell. I just wondered, the lady that wrote that real positive letter to you, have you ever had a chance to meet her?
No, you know what happens at the end of the year? When you win stuff, everyone just goes their separate ways. You have your like 3 days of celebrating the wins, and then everyone goes their separate ways, and I ended up at the Leeds Rhino, so never got back to the person for it.
Never went back to Bradford?
Well when it came out that I was moving to Bradford, in my last home game at Bradford, everyone had been booing me every single game, right? And when we came out for the last game, someone had done a big placard, right, with my head in a noose, wasn't it, like that? And then I scored a try in that game, and they couldn't boo me anymore, right, but they couldn't clap. So it just felt completely silent. The only person who could hear clapping was my dad just going like that, and that had 20,000 people.
Always check your dad to the game.
Yeah, exactly.
I can't see this. Any other before we move on? Jim?
Just to have you playing, Jamie, do you actually...
do you actually miss playing, and what sort of stopped you from getting into the coaching? You think of all this experience and you've had as a player, what's not progressed that into sort of coaching?
Yeah, so first of all, I think when you first stop playing, you do miss playing, and I did miss it, but I think I missed a really big physical challenge at the end of the week of playing, and what I tried to do was get running involved with it, and that kind of really helped me, you know, doing a big physical challenge on Friday, Saturday, Sunday for an hour, 80 minutes, and then gradually over 2 or 3 years, I got used to not having to do that. What I miss about playing is that shared sense of accomplishment together, doing something together as a group. And when people don't think you can do that. And I'm never going to replicate that, so there's no point wanting for that. The closest I get to that is when I run a marathon, you know, and you run a marathon together. You get down to that, you know, you might not know anyone you're running with, but when you get down to the last 40 minutes and you're in the hurt locker and people are dropping left, right and centre, it's a sense of accomplishment when you get over that finishing line. And then coaching for me, coaching... I was supremely dedicated in my career, and I give it everything I've got. And for me, you know, Willie's there now. Willie Peters will tell you what the level of dedication is for coaching. I'm not prepared to do that. I'm not prepared to sacrifice my friends and family for that, because I did that for 20 years. So I'm going to do the things I'm doing. I want to watch the game, but I want to enjoy my life as well.
One more. Where's the microphone? Can you catch that? Well done.
So there's two I put in that. I think Sam Burgess is the toughest player I played against. You know, I only played against him a couple of times when he was at Bradford, when he was at Leeds. And I think Sam's one of them players, the harder the game gets, the more he wants the ball and the more he gets involved with it. And he's one of those players that you can't mentally get him off his game. You're not going to intimidate him whatsoever. But then I think one of the toughest players I played against in terms of delivering on skill would be Darren Lockyer. I always thought... you know, we had a period against the Aussies, probably about 3 or 4 years, where we were nearly beating them every year, but the guy who come up with the clutch play at the right time would be Darren Lockyer, and he was captain, you know, of the Aussies, and I think that, for me, the player who can come up, can have the calm head under pressure, under most extreme circumstances, to come up with the right play, I think that's real mental toughness, and I thought he did it time and again for Australia, certainly when I played against him.
Anybody else, don't leave here thinking, I didn't let you ask that question. Are you okay on that? Can we talk about your second career now then?
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about the transition, because we've already hinted at the fact that life changes, doesn't it? And then you go from, did we say, a tracksuit into a suit?
Yeah.
Although you don't do suits, apart from on the telly, do you? Yeah. Just suits on the telly. Can we talk about that transition? And?
Yeah, I think for any sports person, it's a difficult transition, because I think generally most walks of life, you spend 15, 20 years honing your skill at something, and then you can do it for the next 20 years while you're kind of an expert at doing it. Whereas in professional sport, you get to that expert level, and then you get to, those 20 years get taken away from you. So you have to pivot and find something else to do and something different to do for me. And as I got towards the end of my career, I began to be glad of my lack of rugby league talent, because my lack of rugby talent meant that I had to be good in different areas. It meant, you know, I had to focus on positive influences, be self-disciplined, work hard, do the right thing by people, develop leadership skills. And I knew they'd be skills that I could use in the real world. You know, being able to spin past the ball 30 metres is useless, basically, when you finish playing. So I knew those characteristics would serve me well once I finished playing. But then it's about finding the thing that suits you and what you want to do. And I think as a player, when you finish, there's no harm in trying a few different things, because you don't know what you don't know, and you don't know what you're going to like and what you're going to dislike. And for me, one of my things in life is I don't like doing the same thing repetitively. Towards the back end of my career, I found the regimented system of training difficult to deal with. And I went straight into that when I went to Hull KR with Direct Rugby. And I just didn't enjoy it. You know, I like to be doing my own thing, meeting different people, doing different things all the time. And it really didn't suit me or who I was. So I knew I had to change and do something different, because I wasn't getting any enjoyment out of it. And if I'm going to do something for 20 years, I need to get some enjoyment out of it. It's absolutely key in what you do with anything. So I think for a player retiring, you've got to understand, you're going to talk about values later, but you've got to understand what your values are. Understand like the life skills that you've learned in professional sport, because you learn some great life skills. Then find something you enjoy doing. You know, find something you enjoy doing and double down on that area, I think, is the key.
Let's talk about values now. We've been talking about values this week at our convention, and you've got personal values and we've got corporate values. Can you talk about your personal values and why they are like they are?
I think your personal values as a human are really, really important to you. You know, you've got to know, I think you've got to know what you stand for in life. You really know. So for me, you know, one of the things I've stand for, I've spoke about before, is delivering on my word. You know, if I'm saying I'm going to do something to somebody, it gets done. You know, no ifs, no buts, no excuses. It's going to get done. I'll find a way to do it for you. And I think that's one of my values in life. Always, always do what I'm saying I'm going to do. Second thing for me is just do the right thing. You know, do the right thing in life. Make the right decision. Do the right moral thing. I think it's huge for me. Do you know what? Sometimes you'll get burnt with that. You will get burnt with that. But so be it. It'll only be every now and then. It's more for that person who burnt you for you doing morally the right thing. And then I think as well, I genuinely care about people. I give a shit about people. You know, people who are close to me, people who aren't close. Because I think that's the difference in life if we all do that kind of thing around people. And they're really important to me. And if you like kind of cross them, you know, if you continually don't deliver on your word to me, if you haven't got the right moral compass, if you don't care about people, then you'll not figure in my life. That's how I see it. I'm quite kind of black and white and clear with that, because I think the things I stand for, I think, contribute towards life and society, and the opposite don't. So I'm quite clear with that, and I think we shouldn't be unapologetic about standing for something and what our values are as a person, I believe.
That's amazing. You don't share my values, you're not going to figure in my life. But you can do that now, can't you?
Yeah, I can do, yeah, for sure.
People can't do that. But yeah. When you're in a team, like we had to change this from Elevenses to one because Jamie had this gig at Ricketts. And it was tight turnaround, wasn't it?
Yeah.
You know? And it gets to be 5 minutes before. And you know, because I know him, he'll be here. And if it won't be here, he'll ring me. So I would stress with the other people, but with you, I knew you'd be here. Yeah. Or I'd get a call to say I'm in traffic or whatever. And that's critical, isn't it, when you're in a team?
Yeah, of course.
Relying on it. If you get people can rely on each other like that, they know that'll happen.
Do you know what it creates? Trust. You know, like trust is such a big thing in teams, I think. And I think being a good communicator and delivering on your work creates trust. And trust, I think, is one of them bridges that if every person in this room thinks about somebody you've lost trust with, right? You think about that bridge and how hard it is to rebuild that bridge of trust with someone, whether that's in business or in your personal life. I think trust is one of them bridges that really takes a long time to build back up with people, and some people might never happen. A way to continually keep trust is just deliver on your word. If you say you're going to do something, just do it. You know, because you
not spoke, hard, is it?
Yeah, it's not hard, but you said it before. That's a choice, didn't you? It's a choice, isn't it, to deliver on you. It's not a talent, it's a choice.
Yeah. You don't need to be talented at stuff if you have those values.
Actually. Yeah.
So, into the world of business and coaches, tell us a bit about this Building Champions programme that we piloted here, how many, 6 years ago?
Yeah, 6 years ago, yeah.
Because we've got some graduates in the audience, so we don't want to talk about it in a minute. But, you know, you came to that. We created the framework for it, and then you came and delivered it. Do you want to talk about it? Because that must have been so different for you.
Yeah, it was hugely different. So the premise of it started out that I was like talking and going doing talks around some of the principles I think made me successful as an individual, as a leader. But you always question the impact of delivering a talk, right? Do people following up on the word? Are they going to make any change? So came up with like a framework around what made me successful, but that's transferable from sport into business, you know, as an individual or as a leader. And then thankfully you suggest to it as a trial period. And then from that, it's gone from strength to strength. You know, one of the things that I learned from you was always get that feedback. You know, what's one thing that went well? What's the one thing that I could improve on? And every program I've ever taken anybody through, I've asked that. And then since 6 years ago, the program's now when it's like, I'm just finishing the fourth reiteration of it now, trying to change and adapt to what people and how they like it. So for me, it's been a change, but it's a different kind of change. I think the way to coach people in business is different to in sport. Sport, you can be, you know, a lot more direct with people, but there's also a lot more emotion involved with people. And I think, you know, it's taught me a lot more about listening, about understanding other people as well. It's just been really, really, really enjoyable. Really, really enjoyable. I love it, you know.
I was going to ask you, what's the skill that you've most developed in that time? You'd say it was listening, would you?
I think it's listening and asking the right question. I think they're two great skills to develop in life. If you can listen well and give people space to talk, and then also ask the right question after you've listened properly to someone. I think if you listen properly to somebody, then you'll generally ask the right question. And the biggest like tip I learned around listening properly is just when someone's talking, just try and repeat back when you talk to them a couple of words that they've used, because there's no way that you can't listen properly without doing that. It's impossible. You cannot do it unless you listen properly to somebody, and usually that'll lead into the right question to ask them as well.
Yeah, you've become a great listener over this five or 6 years. You know, I just wish I could replicate it.
You're good at it too.
So we've got four or five graduates of the first programme in the room. Could you spot a business champion? Early liking spot a sporting champion, or is that totally different?
No, I think you can. You know, I think when I know now from working with people that I think when you get sat down with them, they're really clear about what they want to do and what areas. And I think being self-aware of how you need to improve, I think it's important in sport, but it's important in business. And the best people I work with are really self-aware of what they want to do.
Self-awareness is mega, isn't it?
Yeah, it's huge. It's just, you just can't. Yeah, it is mega. And I think that's self-awareness of what they want to do, then how they want to do it. And then they come back and they've delivered on the word. They've done everything they were say they were going to do. You know, and they're the three things I think, well, these are going to go a long way in business because they're doing the right thing. They're self-aware, they know how they need to improve, and then they're doing it.
Well, I'm delighted to say from that group 6 years ago, five of the people you coach have made CEOs in this business, which I think is amazing, and we're going to do some filming later on. And that's your reward for coming here, giving you some case studies.
Yeah, so
but
amazing.
I think we've got some of those people in the room, so we'll reunite you. We can say, you know, we did good, didn't we? Didn't we, JP?
Yeah.
would anybody go first, Tim, on the reflection? just a reflection on that programme. And
so, Jamie, yes, I was part of that first intake, and one of the things that has really stuck with me, and it's still, I use it now, and people in the room that are in our team will have heard me say this to them. It's hard, actually, because we've heard about your tremendous CV, and some people will find it really hard to believe that you thought you were quite ordinary as a player and you had to do different things to elevate you to the point that you got to. But one of the things you talked about was anybody and everybody can be ordinary at what they do, whether it's sport or business or whatever. But if you want to do that elevation thing, you've got to go the extra mile. And people will be familiar with that phrase. But what you said was that if you're going to go that extra mile, when you actually look around you, when you're on that extra mile, there's very few people, and you don't see many people doing that extra mile. And that's really stuck with me, and it's something that I try and encourage people in our team to just think about.
Yeah, it's great. It's true, right? It's the truth, though, isn't it? Like, the extra mile is a decision if you want to go above and beyond what others are doing. And not everybody wants to do that, you know? So I think it's a great way to maximise...
The choice, isn't it?
Talent. Yeah, it's just a choice about whether you want to do that or not. No God-given right to be on there. And I think it can stand you out from others.
The other thing as well... Sorry.
So living in the extra mile, rather than going the extra mile, is the one thing that you took from... Sorry, Tim, what else?
No, all I was going to say was people who maybe don't know rugby league as well as you do, when you talked about captaining Britain to beat Australia, one of the things you told us at the time that more people have walked on the moon than captain Britain to success in Australia.
Yeah, it's a sad state of affairs, that, isn't it? Should have won more than that, yeah. So, yeah, it's true. It is true, that, yeah.
Well, who else have we got? Chris? Is it Chris? You're not going to throw it that far. You're a referee, Tim. You're not a player, you... Look at that.
Oh, you woke him up.
Hi, Jamie. Hi, everyone. I can't actually believe it's 6 years. I said it was 2.5, 3 years and was miles out, obviously, but there we go. As you'll see, Jamie, one thing I didn't adopt was eating broccoli for my breakfast.
No, Chris,
there's always room to work on it.
Not all the advice he gives you is good advice, as
Chris,
I would
say. Stop there. Most of the people in this room don't know about eating broccoli. We'd just better explain that. Jamie, 2 minutes on the bloody broccoli again.
I just prided myself on being self-disciplined. So for me, you know, we got told to eat broccoli. It's a good vegetable to eat. Most of the lads would only eat it at training when they're forced to do it. I thought, I'm going to eat this for my breakfast. So I used to eat it like raw with scrambled eggs just to... make myself be a better player.
Just to talk to yourself.
Yeah.
But no, broccoli aside, I did earlier in preparation do a bit of reflection on the content of the programme, and what I said in my little case study earlier, Jamie, was how relatable it was from going from sport to business. All the basic disciplines that you taught us there and reinforced with us are all relatable. So I think one thing I took out was around hard truths. And a particular comment you'd said about the standard you walk past is the standard that you accept. And it is that you've got to have those difficult conversations and obviously pull people up on any standards that are below, you know, what we want to be as a business. So that was a really good lesson learned, I think.
That was yours, Chris, yeah. Thanks. Yeah. Who else have we got? Mark? Mark's another one.
Hi, Jamie.
Hey, Mark.
Again,
your body looks
ago.
Different to Chris's.
I eat my broccoli.
you're eating the broccoli, aren't you?
I avoid the beans, Paul. I eat the broccoli. Much in what Chris was saying, but the one thing that struck me was it was around habit building. So it allowed you to create that distance and that take that step away from the day-to-day, and then you plan out what you're doing, you do it, and then you reflect upon you doing it, and you refine it again. That's what I really liked about the course.
Yeah, it's huge doing that. I think that ability to just consistently do the same thing over and again and repeat it through reflecting and reviewing. I think a lot of us, we look forward all the time, don't we, rather than just thinking about how can I just be a little bit better today, what's going to improve a little bit more.
So the review's important.
I just think the review's huge, you know. Like I always try to finish my day with that, you know. what's the one thing I've nailed today, what's the one thing I've done well today, and just have a quick look back. Then I set my day out for the next day going
forward. You still do that every day?
Yeah, yeah, because I want to know what I've done well that day. Some patterns coming through. But then it's a good way of looking back at the day and thinking, you know what, I have done some... You know, we often focus on things we don't do well during the day rather than things we do well. And we do loads of good things during the day. And then I'll focus on just what I'm going to do the next day. And that's a good way to make it stay really organised.
Specs, you did the programme, didn't you?
There'll be, I don't know what the fourth reiteration of it is now, but the original one that I'd done was sort of 8 to 10 key things. And I've actually got the book here, I brought it with me, and there's four things that I'd sort of starred in there as I'd gone through and filled it in. But similar to Chris was around hard truths, so my role is very different now. And I've used some of those principles in terms of having conversations with people around that quality bit. But it was also about hard truths for yourself, which linked into some of the self-belief and self-discipline that sometimes you actually need to give yourself some hard truths if you've not been disciplined enough, or you've not given your team enough, or you've not celebrated the wins. So it was more around the self-reflection side of stuff, and am I doing a good enough job for the people that I work with? And I've still tried to say, and I say it now and I talk to Paul about it quite often, can I look myself in the mirror and know that I've done the right thing, that I've done enough? And I think that's something that anybody in this room can take from that.
You turn hair into Mrs. Hard Truth.
Oh, she's
a beast. I wish you never bothered. Yeah, the hard truth stuff, Jamie.
Yeah, just I think Ricky's right there that you have to first of all start with in yourself. And you know, a few rugby lads are here and they'll know there's a great coach Wayne Bennett, and he always says, you know, we're all good at lying to ourselves. You know, we are all good at lying.
We worked with Wayne recently, haven't you?
When it was the England and Great Britain tour manager. Yeah, so he was amazing. He was outstanding. I think sometimes you don't want to meet people who you like. You think are just brilliant and amazing, but then you met him and he was everything and more. You know, he just delivered it all over. I was fortunate that every morning I got to go. He likes to run in the morning, do 2 or 3 mile. And I used to go running with him 2 or 3 mile, and I thought, I can't believe this, I'm running with Wayne Bennett, this is a privilege, this. I'm getting paid to do this, to listen to this guy impart 60 years
That's
of
great
wisdom.
Though, because even Jamie Peacock can get his rocks off about running with his hero, because we've all got him, haven't we?
Yeah, exactly, yeah, he was, yeah. And then falling back to our truths, I just think a lot of people find it difficult to do, to hold people accountable, but you just got to do it, you know, and I think if you see someone doing something that's not right for the team, or sporting team, or an organisation, and you don't tell them, you're actually being unkind, I think, by doing that, because you're allowing them to go down a track where the performance is going to drop, they're going to hurt the team, but you're actually being kind to them by saying, you know what, that needs to improve, you know, what you're doing on it. I think hard truths is a form of kindness, do you know?
It's feedback, isn't it? It's creating a feedback-rich culture, and people ache for feedback. Yeah. Sometimes you give them it, and you think that people should ache for it.
Yeah, exactly. And I think the best people do. And I think as a person as well, it's all right to be a bit pissed off if someone gives you some feedback at first and go, I'm not having that. But then go away and think about it and go, do you know what? They probably are right. It's not wrong with having a bit of pride in your performance. And sometimes if you get feedback on it, it can sting a bit. But I think that's acceptable, that's part of, because you want to be an high performer. Someone's criticised what you're doing or critiqued or give you feedback on what you're doing. That might hurt a little bit, but I think that's part of the process of coming back and going, do you know what? You are right. I actually am going to work on that for me.
After the transition in the business world, and you say you're on the third iteration of your Village Champions thing, is there any best practice you've seen around the place where that might benefit these guys, where you think, you know, I work with that company there or that team there, and that's a bit of best practice that could help us?
I just think I go in lots of different businesses and you can see the different levels of standard. And I think, like, you guys are a pioneer in this, is that just investment in developing yourself and being self-aware. And I just think the best businesses allow people, they employ self-aware people and they allow them the environment to develop and give them that feedback in the right way. And I think they're the keys that I take forward from it. I think in sport, you're doing that all the time. You always get feedback on your performance. It's really black and white with what you're doing. And you're given that room to develop by going out and training and doing that. And I think you can apply that in businesses, and the best ones do it like yourselves, that you get self-aware people without an ego, and you give them the space and room and help to develop as a person and encourage them to do it. And I think they're the keys, I think, in life.
Great. We're moving into the last bit now, so we'll throw it open to any general questions, and it can be questions about rugby league now as well. But have we got any more questions for Jamie while he's here? We've got at the back.
Thanks. Hi, Jamie. Mine's one, it mixes between kind of the two eras of your life. So you spoke at the start around, you know, you now work for yourself, so if you're not excelling, you're not delivering, you're not going to get any work, no one's going to want you to come back. But then later on, you discussed how actually you used to get the greatest sense of achievement by working as a team and, you know, performing as a team. How have you found that transition, and, you know, what do you get your sense of achievement out of now if you're essentially working for yourself?
Yeah, it's a great question. So my sense of achievement obviously would come from, you know, going in somewhere into a business and doing a really good job and helping people to change and seeing that impact with people, seeing people develop. I think that's a real achievement when I go into business and, you know, connecting with people and help them improve. You know, I get a sense of achievement in that. I get a lot of sense of achievement out of my kids, to be honest. You know, it's a fucking cheesy answer, but it's true. You know, like, they're at that age, like 12, 14, 18, where lots of different achievement comes. They're growing into young adults. So the stuff that they do, because I think sometimes, you know, if I'm being honest, to be, like, really dedicated in rugby, you can sometimes neglect being a really good father around things, and I think I've got a lot more space to be a better dad, I believe, in my eyes, you know, whereas I'm not 24/7 thinking about the game. So a lot of my sense of achievement comes through my relationship with my children, I think. Certainly, yeah. And then the group sense of achievement is just enter a marathon and just shout at people in the last half hour when they're all dropping and say, come on, we can finish this. And I get that sense of achievement there.
Because you've been with Kevin, haven't you, and helping yeah. the Rob. Do you want to say just a little bit? Because that's amazing, isn't it?
First of all, you know, the inspiration Rob's shown us all is...
Sorry,
huge.
This is, we're about to tell people. It's Rob Burrows who you played yeah. with, who got this...
So terrible. I played with Rob at Leeds. He got MND, diagnosed December 2019. Awful disease, you know, muscle-wasting disease. And he was given like 2 to 3 years to live. He's still with us now. But he's become like a public icon for the fight against MND. And what all you're seeing is what I see as a teammate, you know, a guy who was really brave, really courageous, had a fierce will to win, but had a sense of humour and a sense of mischievousness about him. And you can see he's showing that in his fight against MND. And he's also showing that selflessness about him, putting himself on the stage, putting himself out there to be that ray of light for people who are suffering from MND.
That must be pretty sobering for you to see your mate
That's awful, going through that. Yeah.
Like,
well, I you know, it's really odd. You know, I found out, I come back, I've been to America and come back, found out in the car, I was just in pieces, you know. It's just, yeah, it's not nice at all. And it's not nice seeing it. But then the thing which has been great from it has been Kev. He's helped him along. So
Kevin Sinfield.
Kev Sinfield's his teammate. He's one of our teammates. And, you know, we all got together at the start. We played a game, got dinner together, got him like £500,000, you know, decided to look after him. Then Kev goes a step further, you know, runs 7 marathons in 7 days, all under 4 hours, ridiculous time. Then we think that's it. But then he runs 100 mile in 24 hours. And then his latest challenge was to run 7 ultramarathons in 7 days. So an ultramarathon is anything over 26. So basically run between 35 and 41 mile a day for 7 days from Edinburgh down the country into Old Trafford. And for me, you know, you see, I'm glad the world's getting to see what Kev's like. You know, you've seen a guy who's incredibly caring, who's dedicated, who's committed, who's hardworking, gives a shit about his mate. And I think you're seeing, you know, great friendship, and I think they're inspiring people, kind of.
You know, that Rhinos team, that winning team at Rhinos, we're all nice people as well, aren't they? You know, you don't have to be a bastard to succeed in sport, do you?
No, you don't, no, and I think, you know, I think you have to be ruthless and committed to what you're doing, but, yeah. You know, being a bastard around it, I don't think it's going to ever get you too far. I think you can be aggressive and ruthless in the game, but you don't have to be a bastard with it. What Kev and Rob are doing are I went on the run with them, and I run like 41 mile with them from Middlesbrough down to York. And the thing that stood out for me was just how good people are, you know, wanting to give money and wanting to donate, stood in the rain, trying to give money, and I just thought, you know, it's crazy. It's, yeah, amazing.
Lovely. Any more? Another question? We've got time for one or two more. Lachlan?
Okay.
Hang on, wait for the box, Lachlan. Don't drop it. Don't drop it.
Knock on.
He's knocked it on.
Nah, just for myself and probably a couple of boys here coming to the end of their careers in the back end, but just like going, did you know what you wanted to do after rugby league, and did you have that self-doubt again going into the business world side of things?
Yeah, it's a great question, and yes to both. So yeah, I knew what I wanted to do, and I had a lot of self-doubt around it as well, and I think the key is that don't worry if the first thing or the second or the third thing you do doesn't work out for you. You'll find something, because you've learned enough good life skills in the sport of rugby league to allow you to be successful at something. And I think that's the thing that really helped my self-doubt, was the thought to myself, this game's taught me so much. To be successful in this game in a team, you need to learn some core life skills. And you've got to work out where in the business world you're going to apply that. And don't worry if the first, second, third, fourth opportunity don't work. You will find something, just because your ability to get on with people, your ability to deliver on work ethic and all that. People want that. You know, people want that. It stands out, I think. So, yeah, that's what I'd say.
Most people going into business fail the way to success anyway. Failure always precedes success, so just get out of the way early. Anybody else before I ask him the key question? Yes, there is over there.
Need the box.
Jimmy, just one on player welfare, really. Looking at the clip beforehand, you've took obviously a lot of big hits and whatnot over the years. Whether you think sort of the human body is really designed to take that amount of punishment, and do you have any sort of concerns about later life or knock-on effects?
I think that right now, I think they've got the protocols right in rugby league around concussion and how you return back to play with it. I think, you know, if you take too much of the collision out, then we've not got the sport we all love anymore. And I think as a player, you kind of know what you're getting involved in. You know, it's no mystery that you're going to get hit hard and there's a chance of you getting knocked out. But all you ask as a player is, when you do get knocked out, that you get looked after properly afterwards. If I get, you know, early dementia, I have no problem with that, because I understood towards the back end of the game the price I was paying, and that's it. Then so be it. So for me, I sit comfortably with that. I think that the way the game's gone, they've got the right stuff involved with now, and I think as a player, you're naive if you think you're going to go all the way through your career and not suffer some kind of like aches and pains afterwards, you know. But it's just about making sure we do everything possible we can without diluting the sport too much to make sure players are looked after. And I think we're almost there with it, yeah. You know.
Yeah. It's the thing that made me most proud of getting involved with Hull Kingston Rovers when I found out we're number one for player welfare.
Yeah.
I think it starts there, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's got
to look after, if you look after your players, and that was brilliant.
Yeah.
Anybody else? He won't be coming back anytime soon. Yeah, we've got one here.
It's clear that you've had a really successful career. Where do you think you'd be now if you didn't get off the bus and capitalise on that opportunity?
Still in Halifax, probably. I just think, I don't know, you know, in my old job I was working, I worked for, those with no leads, I worked for Infarnels in the electronic department for DHL, but like just before I signed, I was in charge of like four lads, so I've worked my way up to be in charge of four, so maybe working for them somewhere. But, you know, it's a great question, but I'm incredibly grateful for the life Rugby League has given me, you know, the values it's taught me, but also, like, the people I've met along the way. It's all about the people. I think when you finish playing, you remember the trophies. They're great, you know, but they're in a draw somewhere. It's the people you meet and the opportunities I get to meet new people that I'll always love about Rugby League.
It's been great for us to meet you.
I think likewise, Paul, likewise.
The last question on Elevenses is always this. If you could tell this lot just one thing, what would it be? And unfortunately, with that bloody late, you didn't get it briefed, so answer it on the hoof.
On the hoof. I think a big thing, right, is go positive and go first. You know, I think that's a really big thing in life. It's just to be positive and go further to people. And I just think, for me, you know, doing that since I've retired has really worked out well for me. And I think, like I say, you might get burnt from time to time with someone who wants to take the piss with that. But I think in life, go positive and go first. We all did that. The world would be a miles better place, wouldn't it? So I think, for me, that one.
Jamie Peacock.
Cheers. Thank you, Paul. Thanks for having me. Thank you.